Welcome to ATCM, the Emergency Medicine Channel. Today we will discuss about thrombocytopenia. Platelets are actually designed to produce a clot whenever there is a bleed in our body. So it's a major component of blood. Whenever there is a small injury to our body, first platelet will come and aggregate in that part and produce a clot there. So whenever our platelet count is less than normal, we can call it as thrombocytopenia. Normal platelet count ranges around 1,55,000 to 3,50,000 per cubic millimeter. So that is a normal platelet count. When the platelets drop less than 1,50,000, we can call the patient is having thrombocytopenia. So thrombocytopenia is again divided into three major classification. One is mild. Mild is platelet count 1 lakh to 1,50,000. Moderate is 50,000 to 99,000. And severe is less than 50,000. So thrombocytopenia is reduced platelet count. 1,50,000 to 1 lakh is mild. 50,000 to 1 lakh is moderate. Less than 50,000 is severe thrombocytopenia. Now we'll see what are the causes for thrombocytopenia. The major cause for thrombocytopenia is bone marrow failure. We all know that platelets are produced from the bone marrow. From the bone marrow is failed, you can have anemia, thrombocytopenia or leukopenia. So bone marrow failure is the most important cause for thrombocytopenia. It can be marrow aplasia, marrow fibrosis, marrow infiltration by tuberculosis or malignancy, drugs like anti-cancer drugs, linezolid. That is an antibiotic that can produce bone marrow suppression. Then drug induced immune thrombocytopenia. Some drugs induced immune mediated destruction of platelets. So that also can occur. So one of the major cause for thrombocytopenia is bone marrow failure. Second major cause for thrombocytopenia is splenic sequestration. You may be knowing that normally in our body 30% of the platelets are destroyed in normal spleen. So old platelets will be destroyed in our spleen, in the normal spleen. But when the spleen enlarges, you get splenomegaly in malaria, hemolytic anemia, so many conditions you can get large spleen. So when the spleen enlarges, there will be increased destruction of platelets. The conditions like portal hypertension, splenic infiltration due to various condition, large spleen due to malaria or leukemia, all these things can produce increased splenic sequestration and destruction of platelet in the spleen. Now, the third important cause is increased platelet destruction in the blood vessels other than spleen. So, vessel wall problem or intravascular problems like TTP, HUS, DIC, all these things can produce destruction of platelets inside the blood vessel. So thrombocytopenic purpura, disseminated intravascular coagulation, hemolytic uremic syndrome, all these conditions can produce hemolysis and platelet destruction inside the blood vessel. Infection like sepsis, malaria can produce destruction of platelets inside the blood vessel. ITP or immune thrombocytopenia can produce destruction of platelets in the blood or in the spleen. Then heparin can produce sometimes thrombocytopenia. This is called as heparin induced thrombocytopenia. All these things can produce destruction of platelets. Now we'll see what are the clinical features of thrombocytopenia. Whenever you have very low platelet, normally you get purpuras on the skin. Purpura means very small bleeding spots all over the skin is called as purpura. So extensive purpuras can be there, bleeding can be there from various part of the body, especially like gums and small wounds can bleed. And bleeding risk, suppose there is a patient who is having chronic thrombocytopenia, bleeding risk is very less. But in acute thrombocytopenia due to any cause, the bleeding risk is very, very high. And some patients can have increased menstrual bleed that may be seen in a patient who is having ITP or platelet disorder, who is having menstrual periods that you can observe large amount of blood can be lost through the menstrual bleed. The major clinical finding is thrombocytopenia is always small bleeding spots. This is called as purpura. All over the body you can see purpuras. There are different types of purpuras, different causes for purpuras. But in thrombocytopenia, classically you see purpuras all over the body. Okay. Now we'll see different type of thrombocytopenia. One of the major cause for thrombocytopenia is immune thrombocytopenia or idiopathic thrombocytopenia. Previously it was called as idiopathic thrombocytopenia because there was no cause for that during that time. Later it was found that it is due to an immune related problem. This is called as immune thrombocytopenia. Immune thrombocytopenia again divided into two major divisions. One is primary ITP, other one is secondary ITP. Primary ITP means there is no other cause for this immune mediated thrombocytopenia like secondary causes. What secondary causes are due to HIV infection, hepatitis C virus infection, SLE, chronic lymphocytic leukemia. All these things are causes for thrombocytopenia, idiopathic thrombocytopenia or immune thrombocytopenia. That is called as secondary ITP. Primary ITP again divided into acute ITP and chronic ITP. Acute ITP is mainly seen in children. Very rarely it can be seen in adult. It is mostly following by a viral fever. Patient develops viral exanthematous fever. After that, patient develops thrombocytopenia, and it may persist even after the acute event. Chronic ITP is classically seen in adults, especially in women. Age group is 20 to 40. It is mainly produced by antibodies against GP2B and 3A. So that is antibody related problem, chronic ITP. Now ITP classification according to time. So the onset to the clinical presentation, it is divided into three major classes: newly diagnosed, persistent ITP, chronic ITP. Newly diagnosed means first 3 months if you are diagnosing, it is a newly diagnosed ITP. If ITP is persisting for 3 to 12 months, then it is a persistent ITP. And ITP persisting more than 12 months, you can call it as chronic ITP. So the classification according to time is new, persistent and chronic. Now we'll see what are the lab investigation you have to do in ITP or thrombocytopenia. So whenever you do a complete blood count, you can see platelet counts are very, very low. But remember that whenever you get a thrombocytopenia, ask for a peripheral blood smear, because normal routine blood counts are done by analytic machines. They can pick up clumps as a single platelet. Suppose in a clump 10 or 15 platelets are there, it will be picked as one platelet by the machine. But if you ask for a peripheral blood smear, the doctor can exactly count what is the number of platelets in a clump and it will be added. So whenever you have thrombocytopenia, ask for a peripheral blood smear so that you will not have any errors in counting the platelets. So you can ask for a complete blood count, you have to ask for a peripheral blood smear and give an exact count on the smear. Other investigations, like you have to rule out secondary causes like SLE should be ruled out. You can do ANA, anti-dsDNA, viral markers like hepatitis C, HIV virus, CMV, Epstein-Barr virus, toxoplasma, all these things should be asked. Leptospira and dengue should be asked in acute condition. QBC for malaria also should be asked. Prothrombin time, INR, APTT should be asked in a patient who is having chronic liver disease, portal hypertension and thrombocytopenia. SLE also you can get elevated PTINR, and in sepsis also you can get elevated PTINR and APTT. Now all these things are ruled out, secondary causes are ruled out, then you have to go for a bone marrow examination to know whether the problem is in the bone marrow. So if it is a bone marrow induced thrombocytopenia, there will be reduced platelet precursors in the bone marrow. So bone marrow is a test to be done. When there is no other causes are found clinically or lab investigation wise, then you can go for bone marrow study. Now ITP is a condition where you have antibodies against platelets. So platelets will be destroyed either in the blood vessel or it will be destroyed in the spleen. Spleen will detect these platelets which are coated with antibodies as a foreign object, and spleen may destroy the platelet. So The primary aim of treatment in ITP is to remove the antibodies which is going to attack the platelets. So ideal treatment for ITP is intravenous immunoglobulin or IVIG. In acute cases, 1 gram per kg for first 1 to 2 days can be given. So first option is IVIG, 1 gram per kg body first 2 days can be given. Alternative therapies, you can give steroids. Prednisolone can be given either as a bolus dose. IV can be given 1 gram IV into 3 days, then oral dose, or you can straight away start prednisolone oral dose, that is 1 milligram per kg body weight first 4 to 6 weeks. Then you can slowly increase or decrease the dose according to the response. Other drugs which can be given as a steroid sparing agents are azathioprine, cyclophosphamide, danazol. All these things are steroid sparing agents. Instead of steroid, you can use these drugs. You can avoid the side effect of steroids. Another alternative for steroid is rituximab. It's an anti-CD20 monoclonal antibody. In thrombocytopenia, you can use it as a primary or secondary alternative. Another drug which is recently introduced is L-thrombopag. 50 milligram per day is the dose. It is indicated in many conditions where you have thrombocytopenia, but primarily it was indicated in hepatitis C induced thrombocytopenia. Now it can be used even in patients who is having ITP. So L-thrombopag or romiplastim are the two drugs which can increase the platelet count by bone marrow stimulation. So L-thrombopag 50 milligram per day, romiplastim 1 microgram per kg once weekly, both can be used in patients who is having ITP. Now platelet transfusions are reserved only those who having severe bleeding tendency. Otherwise, routine platelet transfusions are not recommended in clinical practice. If the platelet count is less than 10,000 per cubic millimeter, if there is an acute ITP, that is an indication for platelet transfusion. But remember that normal platelet lives in our body for 7 days, but a transfused platelet may live in our body only for 24 hours. So prophylactic transfusions are not recommended. Even if it is less than 10,000, you can wait. If there is a significant risk of bleeding, you can start platelet transfusion. Prevention of spontaneous mucocutaneous bleeding, you need a platelet count above 10,000 per cubic millimeter. If you want to insert a central line or a catheter, you can you should have a platelet count above 20,000. If in any condition you are recommending an anticoagulation, platelet count should be more than 30,000 to 50,000 cubic millimeter. For minor surgeries, like a small procedure, small abscess drainage, platelet count should be more than 50,000 per cubic millimeter. For a major surgery and surgeries like neurosurgical procedure, platelet count should be more than 80,000 to 1 lakh per cubic millimeter. But however, in case of emergency, if the patient can be taken for surgery, during the surgery, patient can be transfused. No need to wait for to complete the platelet transfusion. Whenever there is an emergency, you can start the platelet transfusion and patient can be taken for a procedure. So we have discussed about thrombocytopenia. Platelets are basically designed to produce clots whenever there is a bleed, but when the platelets are low, there will be high chance for bleeding tendency, but initially this will be presenting as small purpuras, and there are different types of causes for thrombocytopenia. Cause can be inside the bone marrow, outside the bone marrow, like blood vessels problem, or it can be due to an autoimmune disease. Whatever it is, we have to find out the cause. Platelet transfusions are reserved only when there is a significant risk of bleeding or if the platelet count is less than 10,000. Remember that chronic ITP patients may have better tolerance for low platelet count. So even in chronic ITP, even the platelet count is less than 10,000 also, doctors may not recommend platelet transfusion. They may postpone the transfusion till the patient have a significant risk of bleeding. Thank you.